So Maris is getting my talk, so we have any questions. How many of you have a problem of some kind in your body? Morris talked about that. But I want to tell you how to change behavior. And I will say this at the beginning. You can't change somebody else's behavior until you change yours first. That's where a lot of people fall down. You know, all behavior occurs in some context. And we learn from our environment.
You know, we have Morris came to our class in Atlanta, and you came to a week, right?
1 week.
2 weeks? Yeah, it used to be 2 weeks. And one of 2 weeks I taught about myself. Because I was starting a company and I didn't be able to do this. I can go well beyond your ability to listen. I had a history teacher in college who said, introduced his him to us in the first year. Going to college is like going to the soda shop and getting soda. He says the soda jerk, we call them, can fix you the very, very best soda he knows how. But whether you drink it is up to you. And then he went about reading notes that he'd written in '06. And he was not a good teacher. I liked him, but didn't learn his history. I read so much about motivation, you know, like where it comes from and that sort of thing. And Donnell Attell, the executive director of the center, and I wrote a book that we published about the end of the year. And one of the chapters says, motivation is an outside job. So you see, he was depending on us to motivate ourselves. Well, you see, if we knew how to do that, we probably wouldn't have been there anyway, right? Why would we have gone to his class? He was supposed to prepare the environment for us to learn. And if we didn't learn, whose fault was it? It was his fault, not mine. Yes. Now, I love old sayings, I'll probably say some of it. The thing I like old sayings, and sometimes I can't find them to suit my purpose, so I have to make them up. And here's what I didn't make up, but I wish I had. Look, it's true. Talking is learning. Listening. Think about that for a minute. Who can be learning the most in the next hour or so? You and me. maybe you're restless or you go to sleep or something, you don't do much. But I get a lot from you, right? Some of you smile, some of you don't, some of you frown, some of you laugh at my jokes, some of you like this. And guess what that does to my behavior? Does it affect me? Or does it matter? Mm-hmm. And there's another saying that I think will serve you well. You say, well, why am I here? And here's the way it goes. It says, tell me now, teach me later. Most of what you learn in college, you don't learn in the classroom. Because it's a lecture, right? And unless you take good notes, it's gone. Did any of you cram, understand the term we cram for exams? You know, write the last minute you study. Well, that is a measure of the degree to which you didn't learn what you're supposed to learn. The failure of the teacher. See, I have been a trustee for a couple of universities, and you know, the problem with universities is that they think telling is teaching, number one. And they have things that scare you, make you mad, you know, like, you better pay attention or you're going to fail. You ever said something like that? Or, you know, look to your right, look to your left. Who are you going to be here after this class? I mean, stuff like that. I mean, doesn't that just excite you? Oh, God. I can't wait. So, I was a trustee at a little college in South Georgia, and I told him, I said, look, they were struggling for students. And I said, the reason you're struggling for students is you make college hard. And the things that bother them most are probably the least effective in terms of teaching. So I said, I made a couple of slogans for them. One was, at Brooklyn Parker, if you don't learn, you don't pay. In other words, you come to school because you don't know, right? And so if you do everything I tell you to do and you don't learn, who's it on? It should be on me, right? When I was in grad school, I taught a course to the dean. And he was away most of the time. I really taught the class. So when it came time to do the grades, I learned about him. First few times I did this, because every time I would do it, he would lower the grades. I said, why are you doing this? He said, well, the dean of the College of Arts and Sciences says to give too many A's over here. Now, isn't this ironic? That symbol of academic excellence is in short supply in the university. Yeah, I understand why they do that, because they think that if it's hard, then students will learn more. I went to Furman University as an undergraduate, a small school in South Carolina. We got a new president this year. Somebody thought they're trying to introduce themselves to her, and she was speaking a little bit. He said, our daughter went to the Air Force Academy first year, and she decided that really wasn't what for her. And then she came to Furman, and she said that Furman makes the Air Force Academy look like kindergarten. And new press really liked that. Well, Furman's hard. If something's hard, why would you want to go do it? I mean, you look at the school and say, you know, I remember when I was in school, the word would get around which were the easiest classes. Does that happen here? You know, like, if you go to that class, if you attend every time, you get an A. I mean, don't worry about it. I mean, what you learn is irrelevant, but you won't, you know, you'll get an A. And I understand, you know, the law written about grade inflation and light, but see, I think that's lazy teachers. The teacher, I'll tell you ahead of time, here's what you need to learn. If you do, if you know this, then you get an A. And it's clear, right? Here's what you need to take away from this class. But you're supposed to figure out what you're supposed to take away from the class. What you think you need to take away, what Presley thinks you need to take away may be different. So we have an institute now, and we're focused on education, because education in the United States is terrible. It's terrible, at every level, every level. And we're going to try to do that. And I'll show you some data a little later about how we're going to try to improve education. And I don't mean to sound like a smart aleck, but the thing I know is that learning is behavior. And I do know how to change behavior. We have a science of behavior, and it's not psychology, as I mentioned earlier. It's called behavior analysis, so you want to check up on the web or something. Search on behavior analysis and look at all the applications that's been made, you know, for it, you know, over the last few years. Now, Marius gets on me for running over, but I say, you know, reinforcement is hard to resist. And some people early on, we started talking about, said, well, if they know what we're doing, it won't work, right? If they know what they're doing, it'll work better. And so most of our clients, we try to train everybody in the company. We're not trying to get you to do something you otherwise would do. We're not trying to get you to do something today or tomorrow. You know, so if you know what we're trying to do, you can help us. And you can help each other. And that's exactly the kind of thing that happened. I'm sorry if I keep kind of moving, but this post right here is, you know, I like to see you and see how you respond, because that helps me. So I'm kind of trying to negotiate that. Now, I'm going to run through these PowerPoints. I hope it's not death by PowerPoint, as they say. But I'm just a few of the things. Some of it's Morris has already covered, so I don't need to talk about it. But I want to go through that. Then we'll have a break, and then come back and have questions. And you can tell me some what you like and what you didn't.
Morris mentioned the psychology of science of minds. You know, I remember when my first business partner was a football player. He knew about football. He could get the attention. I mean, if he called the President of the United States in those days, he was popular enough that the President would meet him.
I can't hear really, so let me know. Now, you know, when I first came in, I'm old enough, and I got lots of real old stories. And some of the examples I used, probably you don't even know what I'm talking about. But as a clinical psychologist, my first job was in a mental health institute where we were training mental health professionals. The reason we're training them, well, they had an institute to do this, was because there was a scandal in Georgia in the mental health hospital. In Middleville, Georgia, they had 17,000 patients in a facility that was designed to sit in the hospital. So they had beds down the hall, you know, I mean, it was terrible. And so the institute was training these people. Well, we were under psychiatrist. We worked under all psychologists in that day. No, you couldn't.
still tackle what really happens.
And anyway, in the beginning, we had a facility where we had a few patients. Can you hear? Hear them?
Yeah.
And the state, as they typically do, started looking and said, wait a minute, we're spending X dollars out there, and you're seeing like 50 patients a year. You know, the psychiatrist loves them. They fall in love with the patient, so they don't keep for a long time. And so they may have a clinical patient on several years. And so the state said, no, that's not going to work. They said, you're going to have to see more patients. So all of a sudden, we had lots of patients. Well, it was more than the Scottish account, so they turned to psychologists and they got him help. Well, if you had, let's just call good and bad patients, which category do you think we got? And they didn't think, well, we want the hard ones, so why don't you just take the good? And Freud himself said that phobias were a class that didn't respond well to psychoanalysis. And residents didn't want to work on them, so. And my first patient was a woman by the name of Mrs. Cunningham, who was 52 years old. She had been receiving shock treatments for 26 of her 52 years. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, I like to ask the audience, like, been doing this for 26 years. How much longer do you think you would have to do this before it came in? I don't know how long it was, but I suspect it might have been a long time because it was a pretty good profit margin. Matter of fact, she told me that she never saw him except the first day when her husband was talking to him about her, and she was sitting in the wedding room, and he leaned by looking at her. And from then on, that patient was in the shop. But see, the problem was that right at the beginning, and Morris alluded to this, Morris at the beginning, he said she had a desire to return to the woman. Diagnosed her as agoraphobia. I gave you somebody to work with, and she got a desire to return home. She said, oh, thank you. I mean, that's what they helped me. What would you do? I mean, what would be the first thing you'd do? See, my friends say, well, the reason you're a behaviorist is because you're not smart enough to be a cognitive analyst. I said, you are right. You're absolutely right. I don't understand that. And I said, well, but you're being too literal. He says, return to the womb. What he really talked about is return to the safety, the comfort, and the warmth of the womb, right? Okay, so I give you, if here's one that wants to return to the safety and comfort, what would you do? There's nothing that would, nothing about that diagnosis tells you what to do, right? But see, I am so dumb that I thought her problem was she would not go outside by herself. And that I can see, and she can see it, right? As a matter of fact, she would only go as far with somebody outside her house that she could get back. She was terrified to be able with somebody. And you can imagine kind of life. And what happened was that, you know, she would intermittently get, and I know that's why the psychiatrist probably continued to see her, because she would intermittently get better. She'd have a series of shock treatments, and she'd get better, and, you know, after a few weeks or sometime a month, she'd go back to her old behavior. And when we had this institute, he said, well, maybe they could do something with you, because he got tired. They lived outside the valley, you know, at 20 miles away. You know, he worked in the city anyway, so he said, this is just too much. So I'm going to see if they'll take you over there. And I ended up seeing him. Well, it took about 6 weeks to cure her. Now, when I say cure her, I mean, this woman had a full and happy life for 40 years. And I know that because she sent me a birthday card every year, and we talked around that time. And she updated me on what was going on with her, and she asked me about my family and how things were going for 40 years. She got a job. She took 2 trips to Scotland with her husband, who was in the bankrupt family. She loved herself. She did all these things. Well, you see, the learning theory at the time was that if you, your behavior is basically a symptom of something inside you. It's like, you know, I don't know whether it be the stomach or the heart or the head, but something bad in there. And this was such a mark of recovery, of cure, that I was asked to present her what's called grand rounds. The grand rounds is really enough. Where everybody comes for about a case. And it was a strict city order. They're like the psychiatrists out in front, then the residents next, the psychologists next, and our interns next, and then social workers next, and you know, all that. Very formal. It was never said do that, but that's exactly what it was. Well, at the end of it, the residents, I heard they were going to sharpshoot me. They were going to start shooting down, you know, shoot holes in. And rather than asking me questions to try to trick me and trap me, they asked really good questions about, well, how'd you do that? How'd you do this and all? And it bothered one of the staff members to the point, and he gets up, and it was a damn theater, but he was sitting on the side of there because there was an overflow crowd, because they wanted to see the psychologist, I guess. And he stood up again, and he pointed me, and he says, "This man is dangerous." I just thought I was doing my job. I'm dangerous. But what he said is that she's going to develop something other than it, because he didn't deal with the real problem. And he didn't tell me what the real problem was. What I did, I took her to the front door of the building. And I said, "I'm just going to have, let's see how far you can walk down this step. Walk. You got to come back. Well, you can only come back. Well, how long did you before you met your wife?" She was not even open the door. I said, "Well, I just cracked the door." "No, I couldn't." I said, "Why not?" She said, "Well, I might fall out." "No, just cracked a little bit, but I still might fall." "Well, if you fall, I'll pick you up." "No, but I mean, the door might shut behind her. I'll open it. No, it might lock. I'll unlock it. Nobody might jam. I come around back. Wouldn't they be locked too?" And I learned very quickly, you can't reason with one reasonable person. And a fear is basically the phobia is exactly a fear, right? This is unrealistic. It's just me by half. So what I did was, you see, and sexuality is a problem, we're looking at tendency. What I was able to do, the first day she would stand with the door cracked, what could I do? And the day she held it open behind her, what could I do? And the day she stood and turned it loose, what could I do? And she just one step like this. And 2 weeks she was walking by herself around our campus. And then she walked about half a mile on the outskirts of the campus. But by conceptualizing the problem that way, as not a mental problem, not something inside her, but her environment caused her to do that. Now, let me just say one other thing. You know, most of the time, in Freud's work, and it was a dominant theory at the time. Sex is involved, right? And a lot of people didn't want to come to therapy because they're afraid, you know, I'm going to ask about sex. And I found myself saying, because most people that came to therapy were women and young women. I was young ones. And I found myself in this tough situation because I want to say, "Tell me about your sex life." But it couldn't. It wasn't relevant. And here's the thing that traps so many people. Yes, they want to tell you about how hard their life has been, the trouble they've been. they behave now. But we work for behavior, but we don't talk about it. You know, I know it, you know I know it. That's the last time we talk about it. Don't talk about that, talk to somebody else. I had one patient who had been abused, sexually abused by her stepfather. And she ended up seeing me because she was depressed. She was depressed all the time. She had everything going for her. You know, she looked around, she had everything going for her. She married a lawyer. She had two very good daughters, went to school, healthy. Wasn't making good money, lived in a nice house. She didn't work. She played tennis. But she was miserable. Part of the vision was that she couldn't seem to let go of the fact that she said to me, I just wish I could forget what my daddy did to me. And I said, no. You're never going to forget it. You keep talking about it. What people realize is that if you talk about it, it's just current. It's not something that happened in the past. It's now. Mm-hmm. And so that behavior was, in fact, it wasn't like something happened 20 years before. It's happening for now. And so all I would tell my patients, look, you get one chance to tell me that. Because you want me to know about it. And, okay, it's always in. But from now on, we're going to talk about it. What we're going to talk about is what you do from now on, this day, from now on, what behaviors do you not engage in, that you should engage in, and so on. Let's figure out what it is that will help you do the things you want to do. Talking about what happened yesterday is not going to work. Mm-hmm. We're not going to spend a lifetime, you know, rehashing, you know, old behavior. So we're talking about something in the future. From this time on, see, this is why, in the workplace, which I've been in the last 45 years, I mean, you can't train every supervisor to be a psychiatrist, right? I've been married about a week. I think we tried to figure this out. I think it's 58 years. And the thing about that relationship, you know, it's a bit of a relationship. I'm trying to make some up. Sex in you. No, I didn't do that. I said, look, I finally just said, look, if you're not paying, don't worry about it. I'm not going to do it. But in reality, I couldn't do it anyway. And all my friends thought I was trying to read minds. Some of them feel like that. So what I do is just look at behavior. I mean, you know, if you got a problem, let's see if you can't get it. What that is. What is it about what you're doing that you don't want to do, or vice versa? Let's move on. Let's get up here. That took 6 weeks to change this kind of character. The one I just talked about with the father, the stepfather, I had lunch with her too. She said, I need to come by and get you up on what's going on. She's retired now, and she's but her problem, you know, it was a month or so. As a matter of fact, I remember telling her one time, she said, well, I said, the problem is not, you're not. She said, well, I'm still working on that. See, I understand that why the patient would fall in love with a therapist because, I mean, I didn't have any requirements for what to like her. See, I said, you know, let's get to work on your problem. And so there's a release of anxiety just there, right? You know, she associated me with feeling free to, whether it be judgmental or critical, just want to say, just a second, and let's just talk about what we did. And so I said, if I'm going to continue to see you, you got a problem. So you need to tell me what, you need to come up with a problem for me to do that. Because in fact, this is not a social relationship. Now, it's hard to stay out of somebody's mind. And we do it all the time. If we say somebody's lazy, where does lazy reside? Doesn't reside in me, right? And I say, you're lazy, so where is it? Mm-hmm. It resides in you, right? Notice what I'm saying is, you are lazy. So let's get inside their heads, get inside them in some way. You behave in a lazy way, which I'll try to pinpoint, and say, will you change that? Because you're going to work here, you can't be that. So let's change that to some other thing. And it's hard as we communicate with people to stay out, you know, when you begin to use words like that, you know. And so what we find is that we don't blame people for behaving lawfully and then around them. And we're trying to get management to understand that if you have a high turnover in your business, then you've created an environment that causes people not to want to be there. And so when you have a problem, you don't say, well, that guy was a man, at hospital said, oh, that guy was born lazy and worked at it ever since. He was always pointing to somebody as the problem. You know, you're the problem. There's a company we work with, it's called Dollar General. $7 an hour, and you have to get stuff off the shelf, put it on the very belt. A very routine job, low paying, all kinds of things that people don't like. But in order to get a job there, you have to be recommended by somebody who worked there. In other words, their friends came and so on. And they made that a place where you want to be. And one of the reasons was that the center manager says, whenever somebody did leave, even if they moved or whatever, he would get his managers together and he'd say, how did you fail that person? And before we talk about anything else, let's ask it, you know, what happened. Why'd we hire him? What kind of performance did they do in the company? Did they show they had a problem in the company when they went out on the line? What did they do? When we recognized it for a problem, what did we do? That kind of thing. Guess what they found? Most all the time, it was a flaw in their system, not the person. And so that's the approach we're taking businesses. You know, but if you want to change behavior, and I'll tell you this, whether it's at home, whether you're home, or in school, or rather think about changing the person, changing the environment. But that's going to change your faith. What you find, of course, is that we our systems and processes, procedures at work, were not designed by somebody that understood behavior. And it's not a fault. I'm not blaming anybody, but most of them, like employee of the month and pay and bonus and that kind of thing, were designed by financial people. And then we wanted to make a dollar and cents kind of sense. But the problem is that if it doesn't make sense to the people, then it's more expensive than they figured out. Because people aren't going to work like they should. You know? I think it's true. If you have a rule, somebody's going to have. either the person that made the rule, going to have to keep on following, or the people that follow, going to have to go that far. So we want to try to look at all of our systems and say, wait a minute, how will this help the person do better? You know what I say about, I wrote a book called Hoops, it's 13 next practice, waste time and money. And I went on to say what to do instead, in my opinion, what to do. Performance appraisal is something nobody likes. Why do you keep doing something nobody likes? And the process, they tweaked it for close to 100 years now, and it's no better today than it was 100 years ago. Judge. You know, I deem you a three. I deem you a five, you know. You don't like that even if they give me a five, right? And I thought God was going to do that to me at some point, not you. Oh, you think you are. Oh, I did. A lot of people. There's a movement in the United States now with major corporations and some of them are where they're trying, they say we're eliminating from spread. What they mean is they're eliminating the number of processing patients. Now that's not Mark Smith to stop before I talk. Let me say that the whole thing about the way we manage will change, right? And I do a talk on technology. Ray Kurzweil of Singularity University talks about that the first person to live 1,000 years has already been born. So we're making advances in medical technology. Every year, we extend life one year. He said in 10 years or so, most major diseases will be gone. I just think, I hope I'm being first. And I've got a head start on y'all, so it's amazing. But I thought about that. I thought, I don't know if I want to be on Social Security for 935 years. That's just like a lot of fun. So maybe I'll rethink that. But the point is that technology is changing, and it's changing our world in many ways. But the people that build the technology don't understand anything. We have a big problem in the United States with cell phones. Just to look and see who called is enough, takes enough time to have a record, even if you don't. And what I think is that if the designers themselves had known about tape, and understood something about reinforcement, they would have designed that so it wouldn't work at all. Or don't work in right NC or whatever. I mean, but they could have done that. But they didn't. It's addictive because it produces so many reinforcements. Texting and messaging and all this sort of stuff. I mean, there's a lot of it, right? Now, most people when they hear the term positive reinforcement don't think that. So let me just say, have you heard the term classical condition? I have an awkward condition. Well, a lot of people are kind of turned off by that sort of stuff. But really, all Sinner meant by that was that any behavior that operates on the environment, produces change if you like, will be repeated. It's your behavior. You see, I used to teach a two-day class, the end class, and I was asking the first thing that come in the morning, first hour of the end class, I would say, all right, what I want you to do is I want everybody to make a list of all the positive reports you got hundreds. Because when you turn the water on, what was the reinforcement? Happens almost every time, water can. When you turn off the ignition in your car, what happened? What was that?
Positive reinforcement.
You see, most of the reinforcement we get is not human dependent. And this is the problem, see, a workplace or whatever they design to produce work. And when it doesn't, they want to blame the person. Rather than saying, okay, how can we change that so that, in fact, they will focus on what's wrong. Now, I don't want to be critical, but I was looking at this place. I didn't want to tell you about Harrison, my purple, but just a little bit later. Why? The way that's organized is not a good idea. So you can go tell them right here. Tell them so they won't hit me. But what we know about reinforcement, see, we don't know everything just to know, but I'll tell you that since 1973, there have been at least 6,000 research studies on this. Mm-hmm. And it's not like, you know, some book you read on leadership, they'll have maybe 20 or 30 studies that they talk about. We've got 60,000. At least. I mean, these are ones that have been presented at our meetings. And I could talk a lot more about that in terms of the research and what have you. But when I came here Monday, somebody said in one of the meetings, said, well, how do you know this will work? The work in Holland. So this first time here? Yeah. How do you know this will work here? Work, maybe you're robots, I don't know. What is it? You say, well, don't you have to know the culture? No, you don't. Don't you have to know it? I have to know your reinforcement, his reinforcement, his reinforcement. And anytime I try to reward a group, I'm going to fail a lot of times. You find, you know, food may be a reinforcement of some, but what? Others don't die. So what it requires is that you know people individually. And this is why so much of business is they do it across the board, right? We give everybody a bonus, or we're going to give everybody a holiday, or these sorts of things. And they don't work. But let me just say that they don't work efficiently. Look at some people like it. And that traps management, because somebody tells management, well, I like that. And then 90% of the people did like it. Somehow they say, well, tell me, well, I tried that, it didn't work. Well, we didn't really try. Because this is a personal kind of thing. It's between me and you. So how many people can you supervise? What is as many as you can effectively do it for? If I don't have time to individually learn about you, well, I mean, that's not a very nice place to work, right? I mean, you could be a number and work as well, right? We're talking about, I know about you, and I know the kind of things you like, and know the things you don't like, and so as I work to try to help you get more of what you like. Now, we want to talk about this. What do you talk about?
The effect C square. C square.
What's going
on?
Know these three things, well, you know them some. It's antecedent data basketball. What Mark's talking about is it. An antecedent does not cause behavior. All it does is get you in position to do it. Something in the environment tells you something about reinforcement or consequence. A speed limit sign tells you about a consequence. It may be negative. So, if you see a sign on the road that says restroom ahead, if you're really hungry, that may cause you to stop. time of that, you don't even see. Now, the way we try to change behavior most of the time is to use antecedents. The third chapter of the book, Bring Up the Best, I think it's called Louder, Longer Meaning. If your mama called you to do something, come to interview, and you didn't tell them what you did, she called you again, you said, thank God, a little louder, a little longer meaning. You know, it's like, a lot of people have middle names and say, it's because when your mother calls you by your full name, you know. But somehow, see, the point of this is, though, daily, is that if your mother does this, you say, well, they eventually end up at the table, right? So, the mother gets reinforced from the other kids. Because I mentioned earlier, I mean, baby changes. You change me, I change you. I mean, we're in it together. So, as we think about this formula, then, this year, the AAI conference, our professional conference, is probably 2,500 studies on A. And a lot of people, though, when they hear this, think that's too simple. You can't put all of human behavior in three terms, can you? Well, this is the behavior. Behavior analysis. Well, this is physics. How many terms? Well, this is one. Universe. Just universe. Now, if you understand the model, then what we're saying is this is just people in a position to respond. And we could talk a long time about that too, but basically your history of being asked to do things, that's what if you've been reinforced for it, then when somebody asks you to do something, you do it. Well, done. But see, the child, in many cases, when the mama yells at the child, not because he wants to, but because he's afraid now that she's really getting mad, so I better go. So I think if you try to look at your response to me, then you don't get it. I was like, what are we doing to each other? And when you don't come, I can't get angry. You want me to be angry? No. Well, what could we do to cause you to come more often? Well, it might be that, you know, you serve the meal hot. You come. But see, many kids, and I see this all the time, many kids, they're late and mama's upset. And when they come in, mama's still fussing while she puts the stuff in the oven to eat. So one consequence is when you come late, so you know, I've cooked it. It was nice and hot. And now you spend 30 minutes later, you know. And so what you want to be is you want to be to have this child arrangement with your child and keep it up. And make sure the child won't like it, you won't like it either. Now, here's some things about consequences. Let me just run over quickly. Four things are possible. Two of them increase behavior, and two of them decrease behavior. And see, people try to make stuff hard. I am this down, but I like to make stuff hard. I like to get upset. But the thing is, if you look at the behavior at home or at work, I won't get sicker more often than not. So when I get sicker more often, then I'm gonna use one of these consequences. I'm gonna use one of these two consequences. Because positive and negative reinforcement cause behavior to improve. Positive and what outcome you want. Now, if positive and negative reinforcement cause behavior to improve, why would you need to use one over the other? Positive reinforcement is only consequence that causes behavior to seek the level, the maximum level. Negative cause, when you do a behavior and you get something that you want, then it accelerates that behavior. So the more you get of what you want, then the more acceleration you're going to have. I was talking to a group yesterday about this, and the thing is that when many organizations get in trouble, think about this, and probably not a person, I know in the States is good, not an employee who's not heard from the CEO, either in person or, you know, by communication. Well, this person said, blank, fire more than all this. Black is the most important. People are most important asset. And then as soon as you get in trouble, we do. But your most important asset. I mean, does that make any sense? We're in trouble, so we wouldn't let our most important asset. And why do I say that? They don't believe it. How many times when an organization got in trouble, would your supervisor, your boss, say, hey folks, we're in real trouble. Here's what we've got to do. Good idea. I need your help. So, what happened to you? You're lucky it did. But more often than not, that's the way to get out. We're working on a factory where they make somebody picture, just an old lovely picture that had the long neck on the back. And what they would do is they would fix the innards of it, and then they glue the glass, it was a thick glass in those days, they glued that on the front. And as they did that, they would pull a vacuum to make sure there was no moisture. Well, they had a problem, because at the end of the line, when they checked, they would find the paint on the inside of the picture tube was slipping, which indicated it was moisture. They couldn't find it. You know, it was sort of like, you ever take your car to the mechanic and say, it's making this really funny noise. And they say, well, turn it on, let me hear it. And you turn it on, guess what? And it was kind of that way, it was intermittent. It didn't occur all the time, but every now and then it did. Well, they put their engineers on, you find it, they couldn't find it, they called in corporate engineers, see if they could find it, they couldn't find it, hired some people outside from it. Well, it's about that time we started something called performance teams. And what we discovered was that many supervisors were uncomfortable in a group larger than two, including. No, I could talk to you, I could talk to him, you could talk to you individually, but talking to the others, something changed. And so what we wanted them to do was that their first experience with the group to be positive. And so what did we do? Well, it occurred to me that in all the world, no matter who you are, you ask somebody for help, what will they do? And I was telling them when I was dealing with we were trying to find restaurants. And my brother knew the Italian, he couldn't figure out where to go, and then started eating about 9 o'clock at night. So that's how it's gone. And we saw this little shop where they were repairing automobiles, and there was something in there. And Jamie went inside, he went in, and I see this Italian guy come out, and he said, and finds it. But, and he went, got his car, and looked. And I said, this is too complicated to tell you, so I'll just need you, where you need to go. And I think that's the experience folks do have, right? That if you're a tourist somewhere and you're not familiar with them, you say, could you help me? stop what they're doing and help. So I said, well, let's do is the first thing I want you to do when you get your group together, I want you to ask them to say, I have a problem and I need your help. Mm-hmm. So this particular case, the supervisor says, this group, I have a problem, I need your help. He told about this problem. Mm-hmm. Me! The guy raised his hand. He said, yeah. He said, I don't know what that is. He said, you do? He said, yeah. He said, there's too much pressure on that CO2 line and it forms water in there. And he said, every now and then I'm going to let it out. That was a problem. 18 months in the truck. No telling how much it paid. And it didn't. When the manager came, they said, why didn't you tell somebody? You tell them. When the manager said, why didn't you tell somebody? What is that? Nobody ever asked me. You see, he didn't get the answer. He didn't know, he didn't know like that. That's a problem that they're working on. He didn't know that. But nobody tells him anything, right? Look at, I could have told you, but no way. There's a lot of data now that shows that more heads than we should have set this service, more heads are better than. And when young people are really doing that, and this is sort of a natural thing they do, just like they're doing out here, right? They help each other. And they might say, well, I know how to do that. Oh, good. And then later on, I'm building my reciprocate. So, you started with this, I had that problem. And the workplace don't organize like that. And so what we expect is that the boss tells you what to do, right? Mm-hmm. Would you believe that some employees who do what the boss said even though they're no problem? Mm-hmm. I see, why would somebody do that? Well, it's because, in fact, the environment doesn't fit what they're. We could change the environment in such a way that it would act like that, but it doesn't. So if you see this difference, you see this is the difference. With negative reinforcement, you can see this in the data. We always kind of look at the data, and the data's going to tell you this, because if you get the goal and stop, because they always increase the goal, right? Then don't you say negative reinforcement. No matter what the boss thinks is happening, that's what happens. Sometimes negative reinforcement is hard to see. There was an article in the New York Times a month or so ago, you may have seen it, but it really upset Jeff Bezos, who's the president of Amazon. And it's a very negative article about the culture. And I wrote a blog about it. And somebody said to me, he said, well, now, wait a minute. Jeff Bezos goes in all the places, the factories, he goes there. And nobody ever tells him that. Well, what do you think's going on? They're using negative reinforcement. And if you know you're going to get punished by telling your boss the truth, what do you do? Mm-hmm. What he says, well, how's it going? And that's a big problem in negative reinforcement. You never know what's going on until the other problem. And I think that I know, I don't know him personally, my wife's nephew is working for him. He gets on me every time I say that thing about him. See, he's a good guy. He may be good to those people, and he's got a good philosophy. I think in terms of if you read what he says about the way he wants that organization to operate, you wouldn't disagree with you. That's good. But the problem is, there's all kinds of negative processes that cause the job not to be fun. You know, my first book I wrote it, used an example of bowling. The idea was, you know, how could you make that fun? Well, it is fun for most people to play, of course. nobody wants to do it. You don't have to pay people to do it. You can take something to squat and make it something to function. So there's a big difference between the two. And of course, the theme of bringing out the best of it, that's the only consequence we want to focus on. Now, let me make this point. It's not the only consequence we want to use. My friends don't really know what I do. They have an aim. You know, I've never put all of my tongue from the president. But we'll be in the restaurant, and there'll be a child that's really respected, crying, whatever. And it's like, as soon as he starts, they'll all leave me. And what they're saying, hey, we're a positive group. Well, I showed you there are four consequences, right? Three of them impact the one negative. There's a time to be negative, a time to be positive, and it's certainly it's important to know which one to do it. I'm afraid in our culture, and certainly true in the United States, that there is, some might describe it as a permissive culture, but it's a you're wonderful culture. Everything John does is wonderful and great. You know, never a negative word is heard. But I got news for them. When their kid gets away from them, they're going to have a hard time. Because everybody ain't thinking about it. I talked about very high dog abuse. So I'm getting much sure what's better with you, right? Simon Cowell, who was the original of the thing, was considered by a lot of people to be rude, mean, obnoxious. Well, I think Simon Cowell was probably the best thing that ever happened to somebody. Because they have a cattle call, you know, everybody that wants to be on the stage can come, whether they can sing or not, right? And so they get somebody in there who couldn't sing, and even you would say couldn't sing. You know nothing about music, you say anything. And I remember this one girl, and he said, and she's very quiet. And she said, everybody at church tells me they love my singing. You see, that's where we're reinforcing behavior that should be reinforced. You know, if she asked you, did you like my singing, say, oh, I hear my mother call. I got to run. But don't say, oh yeah, it was wonderful, I love it. It's just like a soccer, you know, soccer's coming to the United States. But when the young kids don't keep score, my friends, she's always right there. She came to the game, and she was waiting for a player, and her grandson saw her, and he came over to the sideline and says, I'm not supposed to know this, but we're ahead 5-3. They know what the score is. You know, is it bad to know the score? Is it bad to know somebody's going to win? My one of my other grandsons is played baseball now. They haven't won a game. How can you protect them from the fact that they haven't won a game, monkey? Oh. So the situation is like where, in fact, we experience negative consequences. And I think it's good that we do because we're going to see those, you know, in life as we go. And we don't want people to be defeated by it. And I've seen children, you can see what they're going to be when they grow up. You're like, I do a lot of observing behavior in airports. And you'll see, I remember grandmother was dragged this little girl, and by dragging her, she was on her tiptoes because her grandmother was always faster than she could walk. And she went by her and said, you've been quiet ever since we got to this airport. I bought you two things, nothing satisfies you, so you can just shut up. I know exactly what I said. You do too, right? She cried. She bought her something. So what they do, crying, increase it. So she you borrow something else. I mean, you know, at first crying's okay, you can tolerate a little crying. Now that, that's why you please shut up. Now see, she was blaming the child for something she did. She positively reinforced the wrong behavior. And so if we understand that the four consequences, the only one of the four that's going to cause you do something that you want to is positive reinforcement. Now, let me just summarize some things. First, attitudes are necessary but not sufficient. That means we need to know what to do. It's certainly better to know what to do. So knowing what to do doesn't mean we're going to do it. It's like people know they should eat something, but they eat it anyway, right? He said, this will make me bad. I'm going to feel bad in the morning. So the thing we know that causes consequences cause behavior. That seems just get you in a situation where you can respond. And doesn't have much control over whether you do it or whether you don't. This is the closest thing we have to a law of behavior as gravity is a law of physics. See, so what we do, and I would buy you to say, well, what do you do when you to a supervisor? Well, people do that for you. And of course, supervisors often get motor reinforcement solving problems. So they're always looking for what goes wrong. And so when people do what they're supposed to do, what consequences do they get? If it's not reinforcing by what they do, then they don't get anything. And Morris said that's extinction. So we always look at what happens when they do that, what happens when they don't. That immediate certain consequences are more common. So that's something that the book I just mentioned we're writing, the whole book is about this. There's some people that want to argue the point. Well, why should it be that way? I mean, that's like children respond the way I know. You know, we have this thing in the United States about adult learning. Are the laws different when you get older? Is that what it is? You learn, the same way. Children learn the consequences, adults learn the consequences. They have to be different, maybe, but they're going to have to be different with anybody. You're going to have to personalize with me. Now, there are some things, don't misunderstand, there are some things that everybody likes. Most everybody likes. Not everybody. Nothing everybody likes. Most people like money and other things, you know, for money. There's some price things for money. But the point is, when we go into an organization, most of the consequences that you experience are not tangible in the sense that something you can eat, something you can put in your wallet. Most of the consequences in terms of frequency are interpersonal. You see, there's not a day you go to work and leave that you're not a different person when you leave than you were when you came in. Because every interaction changes who? You and the person you had the interaction with. And we don't usually walk away from the situation and say, well, I'm really doing better now, I'm changed. But in fact, we know scientifically that that happens. Now, if you're doing something I like, and I reinforce you for it, you do for another. But if you're doing something I like, I get reinforced when you do something I like. So whatever I did to get you to like it, I'm going to do that a lot. Positive consequences, and this is hard for lots of people to manage, to understand. The positive consequences are the most efficient and effective. In other words, from a business standpoint, or a management person, they they make the most money. Those performance is the highest, and most of the reinforcement that you use cost you nothing. We have stingy, you know, like it would hurt me to stay positive. And I know many supervisors told me, would admit to me, I have never ever told a person I like what they do. And you know, maybe just sort of parochial, I guess, in the United States, but in the South, you know, you don't be a man, you don't be a man, it's all called men. And you know, it's just like, it's kind of like women tell people good things. And the only period they have is the model, you know, the model was positive and the dad was a good choice. You know, you have somebody you want, you can really ask call. The size is crucial. I mean, today it's positive consequences for the best of people. So why would you have a culture that would define a positive reinforcement? Well, I think it's because their own personal history sometimes has taught them that yelling gets better results. See, this is like stretch goal. Stretch goal, you might work. You take 10% of the time. But 10% of the time is enough to keep people reinforcing, right? Because it's intermittent reinforcement for doing it. If I do things with other words, it's still negative. Like I do my job because I'm paid. Well, somebody says that, and I know it's negative reinforcement. It's not something you enjoy doing. They'll say, "Well, I do that because I love doing this. I really enjoy what I'm doing." So, think about the action to determine whether or not it's positive. I remember yesterday, you know, I would take everything in mind or something. That's why I talked about it. I remember we've been working with Blue Cross Blue Shield of Alabama for 35 years. Now, by working with what I mean is that they send a new country to a class that I don't know. But we've been working with them, and they want me to do something different with the group. So, at the break, I get back, you know, the first part of the thing we were talking about. The break, I begin looking at my watch, like, it seems like it should be over, and I find out it's been 30 minutes. And so, I have noticed that I was standing on the side, and it was so obvious to me that I thought, well, I need to go back over here and, you know, look good, talk to you. And the first thing, you know, I'm back decided they got it, but I tell everybody, that's when I'm over here. Then gone, or talk to somebody, get supposed to, and when I'm over here, they'll look like more. They'll put a smile, and it was dramatic. But I didn't know it. I mean, I didn't know what they were doing to me. And you probably heard some of my professors tell you that kind of stuff. But it really happened to me. I couldn't. But this is what they're doing. But it's a point, you see, that not only did it apply that way in terms of what social consequences do, but it applies that way what other consequences do. They shape your behavior. You know, it's like when somebody does something wrong at work, you got to ask yourself a question. What are we doing that could have given a person the impression that was okay? What rules and regulations, what way we interact with people, we cause that person to think doing that's okay? We do a lot of safety work. And a lot of safety incidents are caused not by people who are careless, so much as they're caused because of the supervisor, maybe. We've got to get this done. And so people hardly get it done and get an accident or whatever. We're going to be playing. So, see, I think we're entering a time where we're going to rethink all of this. We're going to rethink our processes, please, and say, wait a minute, how does this help people? You see, one of the things we're getting ready to work on the school system in South Carolina. And the problem is, if you look at the school day in terms of how much kids actually are engaged in learning something, it's a very small part of the day. You know, all these other things that they do. And so we're going to say, look at every job and say, how do you help children learn? Can you directly tell me how your behavior helps the child to learn? And a lot of jobs, well, they can't tell, right? And we're not going to fire them, but we're going to say, you need to do something else. You need to help the teacher. The workplace of the future, I'm predicting the work supervisor, manager, and boss will be on the next one. And it's going to be coaching. See, you're that one reason that's helping people. That's how I was imagining. That's why it's all about your job. And so you design processes, systems, and your personal behavior in such a way that you help people do better. And you don't sit in judgment. Somebody is not doing well, then what you should get you ready for the problem is the fact doing things, showing them things, so they can do it better. But unfortunately, many times now, the supervisors can make the case of how it's them. And I think that has to change. With robots coming and doing so much of the work, y'all are going to do a few jobs anyway. So you'll have a way to select the best people to do that. I think those who help us, and this is a criteria I would use for a supervisor. What does that make you really supposed to come? We want it to be not in terms of competing, being first and all that, but seeing other people learn, seeing other people change. That's a big deal for me. And we find people who do that, and we know they're going to be there. But can we take this to do we have 30 minutes left?
Oh, no, it's half past four.
I have
the Laurel.
Is it the
Laurel?
So surprises. So if you take a break for 15 minutes and then come back.
That's a good day. Can you come back? I'll tell you what. I'll come back. She said 15, so I think if I say 10, you might come back and forfeit.
Okay.